During the Second World War, the war effort required mass production of vehicles, aircraft, and weapons, often by converting companies from other sectors of activity. In order to ensure conformity and manufacturing quality, it has become necessary to check not only the dimensional tolerancing, but also to control and check surface texture of manufactured parts. However, the scale at which surface texture appears does not allow reliable visual inspection in most cases. It was therefore necessary to invent new measuring instruments. It was particularly under the impetus of Rolls-Royce, which needed it for their factories, that the quest to manufacture the first commercial profilometer was launched in the late 1930s. Engineers and researchers have contributed to the work, such as Dr. Schmaltz, Ernest J. Abbott, Harry Shaw, George Tomlinson, and above all John E. Reason from Taylor Hobson. John Reason designed and developed the first commercial and autonomous profilometer, under the direction of Mark Taylor. The Stylus 1 was born in 1941. Its simple and effective design is based on the movement of a probe, guided by a reference surface. A stylus records the height differences on the surface to be measured. Over the years, several manufacturers have developed their own profilometers, gradually improving the various elements. Until the 1970s, the profile was drawn on a strip of carbon paper, with a stylus which reproduced the profile on the principle of the galvanometer, from the amplified and filtered signal from the sensor. From the 1980s, the first personal computers allowed the gradual transition from analog to digital, the display of profiles on the screen, and their processing via algorithms. The principle of a profilometer is quite simple. A microscopic tip, in contact with the surface, is moved along the x-axis. The vertical movement of the tip, due to the surface relief, is captured and amplified. The profilometer is generally installed on a z-column, allowing the stylus to be positioned above a part to be measured. The traverse unit moves the stylus along the x-axis, perpendicular to the z-axis. The granite base serves as a reference plane, and as a support for the parts to be measured. More precisely, the sensor slides on a reference bar, thanks to a drive screw, driven by a motor. The bar serves as an internal straightness reference. It is an expensive element, ground with great precision, which often justifies the price of the profilometer. It allows the stylus to record the entire surface texture, be it roughness, waviness, form deviations, or even the form itself. There are also profilometers without internal reference, whose stylus is equipped with a skid resting on the surface, as we will see later. The profile is therefore measured by pulling the tip over the surface at a speed chosen according to the roughness of the part. The speed must be moderate, so as not to risk bouncing the stylus or damaging the surface or the tip. Some modern profilometers allow the tip to be raised and gently lowered to the surface. The stylus itself is terminated by a tip, consisting of a microscopic sphere of a few microns in radius. This sphere, often made of diamond or a hard stone like sapphire, is attached to a conical support. The hole constitutes a conospherical tip. By default, the tip has a radius of 2 micrometers, and the cone has an opening angle of 60 degrees. But manufacturers offer many models of styli, with various characteristics, especially regarding their length and height. The stylus rotates around a pivot. The opposite end of the stylus is connected to a transducer device, responsible for converting the vertical movement of the tip into an electrical signal. There are different transducer technologies. The most common today is an LVDT inductive sensor, where a ferrite core moves between two coils, fed with an alternating current. The movement of the tip changes the impedance of the coil, which alters the frequency of the current, thus allowing a measurement of the relief. Alternatively, some sensors are capacitive. The opposite end of the stylus has a pad that passes between two electrodes that produce an electric field. The movement of the pad changes the capacitance of the capacitor in proportion to the height of the relief. For entry-level devices, including small workshop roughness meters, the transducer is piezoelectric, and like the pickup on a vinyl turntable, it creates an electric current depending on the pressing force on the piezoelectric element. Finally, for high-end and high-precision profilometers, the height variation is evaluated by a laser interferometer. This allows for large vertical excursions, while maintaining extreme resolution. Today, the measured profile is fully digital. As the sensor moves, the electronic samples points at a given frequency, i.e. the altitude is converted to numbers at a given time interval. The spacing between points, called the sampling step, depends on both the speed of movement and the sampling rate. This has an impact on the lateral wavelengths recorded by the profilometer. This is called bandwidth. The vertical value is converted to a digital number, hence the name digitization. This number can be coded on 12 bits, 14 bits, 16 bits or more, leading to a variable number of coding levels. With a 12-bit analog digital converter, making it possible to code 4096 levels, a vertical digitization step of 0.24 micrometers is obtained, for a vertical excursion of 1 millimeter. With a 16-bit converter, 65,536 levels are encoded, which gives a digitization step of 15 nanometers, also for 1 millimeter of vertical range. For profilometers with a larger vertical range, in particular around 10 millimeters, it is then necessary to switch to 24 or 32 bits, and often this requires counting by an interferometer. The analog-digital converters will have reached their limit. The vertical step is just computer resolution. It does not prejudge the measurement uncertainty, which is the real ability to differentiate two close levels in height. Like any movement, the sensor cannot instantly reach its cruising speed. There is therefore an acceleration phase, during which the displacement is not linear, so the spacing between the points is not regular. This is called the pre-travel, which is usually suppressed by the profilometer software. But it is nevertheless necessary to take this space into account on the sample, which can sometimes be a problem with small parts. Similarly, once the profile is measured, the traverse unit gradually decelerates to a stop, creating a post-travel length. The longer the pre- and post-travel lengths, the higher the speed. As we mentioned above, some profilometers are equipped with a skid. The principle is to have a wide pad in contact with the surface, to serve as a reference. This pad smooths the local roughness, allowing the tip to register the differences between this smooth shape and the actual relief, thus approximating the roughness. This type of profilometer is more economical, but it does not measure waviness or form deviations. Today many brands offer pocket profilometers, called roughness testers. The measuring part is placed directly on the workpiece to be measured. This makes it possible to measure surfaces directly on a large component in production. Laboratory profilometers allow more precise measurements, including not only roughness, but also waviness and form deviations. More and more profilometers do both surface texture and contour. The high precision of these devices requires them to be isolated from environmental disturbances, mechanical and acoustic vibrations. This is why some models are mounted on active damping tables and are protected by closed enclosures. Some profilometers are specialized in measuring microelectronic components, even silicon wafers. These very fragile surfaces require an extremely low force of contact, thanks to dynamically controlled force. Models intended for microelectronic component production lines, in a clean room, can receive closed cassettes that contain several wafers, which are loaded and unloaded in the profilometer automatically. Contact profilometers are well-known devices that have been used in industry for over 50 years. We know their characteristics with precision. Their transfer function is reassuring, because the creation of the mechanical profile is a well-described mathematical operation. This therefore makes it a suitable instrument for massive use in industry, alongside with calipers, height gauges and other measuring instruments and equipments. The measuring length depends only on the traverse unit, which can be adapted to the needs. Some profilometers have lateral capabilities exceeding 500 millimeters. The technology is compatible with inexpensive devices that can be used in the workshop. All these advantages mean that the contact profilometer is still today the most widespread measuring instrument for the analysis of surface texture. However, it is also important to be aware of the disadvantages and limitations of the technology. The main drawback is that the touching tip can damage the surface, especially if the material is brittle. The use of a low-force sensor can circumvent the problem. The geometry of the stylus, formed by a right angle between the vertical tip and the horizontal stylus, makes it difficult to measure breaks in slope, such as steps or holes. The stylus moves along an arc, leading to a lateral shift, but this effect is compensated by the internal software. Another major drawback is the slowness of measurement, due to a speed which is generally a few hundred micrometers per second, up to a few millimeters per second at most. This makes it impractical to adapt to aerial measurement with a Y table. Measuring a surface of a few hundred parallel profiles can take several hours. We will then prefer optical profilometers, which are faster, but whose lateral measurement field is more restricted. Thanks for watching this video. Feel free to comment and indicate your needs for future videos. Click like below this video and subscribe to the channel to be notified when new videos are uploaded. Find other useful resources on the Surface Metrology Guide and visit www.digitalsurf.com to learn more about mountain software. Thank you.